We're in a very near-term focused effort to work towards the first power-generating molten salt reactor. And I bring up power generating because obviously with the molten salt reactor experiment, we didn't get to this stage. And as we've been working on this for a long time now, we realized there were many issues that needed to be confronted in order to reach this. And I want to go through how this affects material salts and other choices in the reactor design. We're compelled to look at alternatives to today's power generation because of uncertainties both in terrestrial production carbon emissions and as well as the existing nuclear technologies. And we believe strongly that molten salt reactors are a very, very compelling alternative to the situation we find ourselves in today with nuclear power. The heart of the value proposition for molten salt is the fact that this is the only coolant choice that can operate both at really quite high temperatures as well as at low pressures and has a tremendous advantage there because of this. And you have to figure out, though, what are you going to make the salts out of? And if you look at materials that have low absorption cross sections, you realize there's not a lot of choices out there. The field narrows pretty quickly when you're trying to do something neutronically efficient. Materials like fluorine, and I'll zoom in a little more on this. Fluorine has a low absorption cross section. It's monoisotopic. And lithium is a problem all by itself, but if you can highly deplete lithium in the lithium 6 isotope, you get a really attractive material as well as beryllium. Carbon is an attractive moderator. And so it's not hard to see why the list of materials that you would want to make a molten salt out of is not tremendously long. There are a few other alternatives, but as we'll go through, taking many of those materials and then looking at them from a melting temperature perspective. Most of these pure salts melt at just much too high a temperature to be used as is. Even materials like lithium fluoride are just much too high temperature. But as we put various salt combinations together, we see this attractive feature that we really like, which is we can push melting temperatures down. And the reason that's so important is there's really a region of temperature we need. And it has to do with some material constraints that I'm going to cover here in a moment. And it also has to do with the need that our power conversion system, whatever it is going to have a fairly decent range of delta T. So we are going to have to be above the melting temperature by a margin, have that delta T margin for the power conversion system, and still be below material constraints. And as you can see on this chart of various combinations with lithium fluoride, the combination that uses beryllium, lithium fluoride, beryllium fluoride, can really reach some low melt temperatures at reasonable amounts of beryllium inclusion. So it's not a great surprise that lithium fluoride, beryllium fluoride, which is commonly called Flibe, obviously we named our company after this, is a really attractive material. Here, zooming in on this graph a little more, you see that melt temperature for two-thirds, one-third combination of lithium fluoride, beryllium fluoride is around 456 C. So that gives us 50 C of melt margin as well as 150 C of delta T that we're going to need for our power conversion system while still staying below the 700 C threshold that I'll talk about in just a moment. Now, there are some other mixtures that also get below there. You can see with lithium fluoride, uranium fluoride, there's a potential mixture there, but I'm going to cover an issue with that in just a moment. And then lithium, a 3-to-1 mixture of lithium and thorium has a lower melting temperature, but not as much range as you would want. And I'll show you why that's not going to be a problem in a few more slides here. So these molten salts are very chemically stable in air and water. We like that a great deal. We like their large liquid range. It's not the salts that give us the problem. It's the other materials and corrosions that take place. The salt, particularly Flibe, lithium fluoride, beryllium fluoride, has an exceptionally high volumetric heat capacity, even surpassing that of water. And this volumetric heat capacity is really your fundamental yardstick of how big your reactor is going to be, how you move that thermal energy out from where it's generated in the core to the power conversion system. So Flibe just keeps showing up over and over again as a real winner in here. But wait, there's more. You can add nuclear fuel to Flibe, obviously, as was done in the molten salt reactor experiment, and it has good solubility for that. So here's a picture of Flibe as a fuel. Now, why do we want to use a molten salt as a fuel? Because we can eliminate an entire step of heat transfer by depositing the energy of fission directly in the coolant that can then carry that energy out of the core to the power conversion system. It's a remarkable simplification. And it also gives the reactor tremendous response against transients and changes in power demand. Makes the reactor potentially very, very responsive to changes in power demand. There is an issue, though, as we add uranium fuel to the Flibe salt, and that's that there is a corrosion reaction that happens with chromium in the alloy. And this reaction will take place initially in the surface layer, but it will essentially stop there unless the alloy is at too high a temperature. And then chromium migrates from internally in the alloy structure to the surface, and the reaction continues. So that's another reason we want to keep operation temperature below 700 C with some margin because of this chrome reaction. Now, can we eliminate chrome from our structural alloy? It doesn't appear that we're going to be able to anytime soon. So in the near term, our best bet is to stick to those thermal margins and to operate within them. And again, as you can see, Flibe with a little bit of uranium has the thermal margin needed to operate in this attractive region without running into especially significant material constraints. This is how MSRE was able to operate successfully for so long, is because they respected a lot of these constraints. Now, MSRE did have a much lower delta T across their core. They were about 30 C of delta T. We are looking at about 150 C of delta T across the core for our design. And I'll tell you why in just a moment. When you look at the moderator space, there have been many, many people getting excited about some new moderator. And we would love for there to be a better moderator option out there than graphite. But what we see over and over again is that when you look at hydrogenous moderators, it's very, very easy for them to lose their hydrogen at the high operating temperatures of an MSR. Obviously, we use zirconium hydride and Trigger reactors, but they don't run at high temperature. Beryllium oxide was used in the first molten salt reactor, but it's not stable in the salt. It will react. It will become beryllium fluoride. So you have to clad it. And that's a problem, too. And that's exactly what they did in the aircraft reactor experiment. They ran it in inconel channels. Graphite is the only moderator that we have that we can run unclad in the reactor at temperature. In fact, graphite has just tremendous performance at temperature. So we foresee a reactor that is going to be built of prismatic graphite structures. They're going to occupy the majority of the core. And this is going to be able to enable neutronically efficient designs. Why? Because we've eliminated the need for a clad or a barrier. If you have to have a clad, if you have to have something that goes between your fuel and your moderator, then that's going to present problems because it's going to be a loss term. You're going to lose neutrons going each way, fast neutrons going out, slow neutrons going in, as well as the damage to the material. And these metallic alloys have a real problem with that. So we just don't see metallic structures in the core, in the neutronically active core region, as being a viable thing for future molten salt reactors, and especially not for near-term molten salt reactors. Now, graphite's not perfect. Graphite obviously undergoes dimensional changes. And this is something that is a strong function with temperature. Nevertheless, we are advancing a configuration for our reactor. We would actually have two reactor vessels, only one of which would be active at any given time. And as the first reactor finishes a number of years of operation, we would then pump the fuel over to the second reactor and continue operation while the first reactor core is able to cool down and eventually have graphite reshuffled and replaced. So in this manner, we believe we can work around the graphite issue and accommodate the peculiarities of this material. Another important thing about the reactor design is that we want to have two regions in the reactor, an area where it is neutronically active, we call the core, and a neutronically absorptive region called the blanket. And this is important because we need to protect the structural alloy from neutrons. And the reason why is that there is a reaction that happens in nickel alloys. Now, nickel is just a remarkable material, and nickel was the basis for what they originally called INOR 8. We now know it as Haskell AN or Alloy N. And obviously, we built things like this primary heat exchanger for the MSRE out of Haskell AN. We were able to build all of the primary structures from the molten salt reactor experiment out of alloy N. But under neutronic flux, you are going to have an embrittlement of this material. And that's because nickel will absorb neutrons. It will go from 58 to 59. And then it will undergo an alpha reaction to iron. And it's that alpha that's the problem, that helium accumulates at grain boundaries and it degrades the mechanical structure of the material. So you really want to keep neutrons out of your nickel. Now, there's a place where you don't have thick walls in your materials like you do in the reactor vessel, and that's in the thin walls of the primary heat exchanger. But one of the beautiful things about molten salt is if you design your reactor properly, you can have the neutron flux in the primary heat exchanger be just a tiny fraction of what it is in the core, essentially just residual delayed neutrons. And that's going to enable you to operate those, heat exchanger structures much longer, because you've reduced the neutronic flux that will be in there. So takeaways from this, you want to go with Flibe salt, which is a proven salt, proven from operation in the MSRE. You want to go with Hast alloy N, and you want to go with graphite moderation. These are three materials choices that enable a molten salt reactor to operate in a state of chemical equilibrium. And just to contrast this, I mean, this is something that we don't have even with today's light water reactors. The water is not in chemical equilibrium with the zirconium clad, and the zirconium clad is not in chemical equilibrium with the uranium dioxide pellet. So the fact that we were able to build reactors over 50 years ago with materials in chemical equilibrium is just absolutely remarkable. And I think this is something we should be talking more and more about as a contrast with the way we do things today. It gives us a lot of confidence to go forward in the near term with safe and efficient molten salt reactors built around these three materials. Now, it's not to say that Flibe salt has no problems. Flibe salt does have problems. And one of them is the inevitable formation of tritium, as was mentioned earlier. And even if we could totally eliminate lithium-6 from the Flibe salt, there's still pathways through lithium-7 and beryllium for some tritium to get made. So what do we do about tritium? Well, we've heard information earlier today about approaches that can be taken to mitigate tritium. But our primary approach to mitigating tritium is to use the supercritical carbon dioxide power conversion system as a place that, in a worst case scenario, even if the tritium gets all the way through the primary heat exchanger, all the way through the gas heater, it's going to get captured by the oxygen in that CO2 and can then be removed as a vapor, as tritiated water, in the low temperature operation of the gas cooler region of the recompression cycle. Just to put this in contrast, if you have a steam turbine, then you want to make sure that tritium cannot get into that steam, because if it gets in that steam, you are not going to be able to get it out. So reactors, MSRs that want to use steam turbines have to have some sort of salt between them and the steam turbine, something that they can have great confidence is going to capture the tritium. We're assuming that our CO2 cycle is going to be where tritium kind of goes to get caught once and for all. The other wonderful thing about the supercritical carbon dioxide gas turbine coupled with the molten salt reactor is it achieves very, very good efficiencies on the order of the mid-40s in percent. And this is because of the higher operating temperature and the very compact turbo machinery that the supercritical CO2 allows. So we're very excited about this technical approach. But as much as we like the efficiency, fundamentally, it's about making sure that we can capture tritium and go forward in the near term. About 10 years ago, the Department of Energy released this report on their R&D roadmap, and they made it clear that it is the responsibility of industry in the United States to design, construct, and operate commercial nuclear power plants. And I bring this up because this was a big reason why our company was started in 2011, is only the last 10 years or so has there been an opportunity for companies to make their arguments for what new nuclear should be and what business plan should be built around that and what the product should be. And some of these are very different than the classical nuclear designs and scenarios that have been put forward in the past. An analogy I like to make with people is the old pressurized water reactors we have are a lot like a landline phone. It's really, really good and reliable at one thing. And some of these newer reactors like NuScale, small light water SMRs, are kind of like a flip phone. They're nifty and neat, and they do that one thing in a new and kind of exciting way. But what we're after is analogous to a smartphone. we want to not just do electricity, but we want to do many things. We want to produce heat, water, medicine, and many more products through the harnessing of all of the parts of the fission reaction. And this is what we feel the new latitude and opportunities that are being presented by the Department of Energy allow. And so we're very, very excited about this. Ultimately, our goal is to supply the world with energy and water and fuel that have all of the attributes that the public expects and demands. We believe that through this molten salt technology, we're going to be able to get there. We're very excited. Thank you very much.
From a kind of fuel cycle perspective, I mean, you've been a big advocate for a number of advanced fuel cycles and so on, and you've kind of been the leader of that for a good number of years. What's your biggest challenge you're seeing as like from a fuel cycle solution perspective for either for your reactor or any of these advanced molten salt reactors that we should all take away?
One of the most important thing that animates me, which is to use nuclear fuel very efficiently and to absolutely minimize the production of nuclear waste, does not seem to get a lot of appreciation or support in the nuclear community in general. And it really kind of baffles me because almost any time I'm talking to regular people at any level, you know, non-technical, technical, leadership, et cetera, they always bring up the issue of nuclear waste and how much they would like to see it addressed. Mm-hmm. And I describe our technological approach and what we're doing and why I think it's going to be so compelling. But it really baffles me that this is not something that is weighed and taken more into account as we're making choices as a nation and a world in new reactor technologies.
No, that's a good point. Why go with a proven salt if you then go with an unproven power conversion cycle in nuclear?
Yeah, the SCO2 is unproven, but fundamentally it's about tritium capture. We need to be absolutely sure that we are going to capture that tritium in a very simple and defensible way. And there is a lot of work going on in SCO2 from many different sources, most of it not even in nuclear at all. But that's a valid question, valid concern. And I think simple answer is tritium. Tritium is why we do it.
What are the main material or element constraints to using Flibe in large quantities as would be required for wide deployment of lifters?
That's very simple. Highly depleted lithium. Highly depleted lithium is the limiting constraint on making large amounts of Flibe salt.
Yeah, it's interesting. So there's a really interesting fuel cycle supply chain kind of questions coming in there. So it's something we need to be aware of. A bit like that, you know, the high assay LEU and so on. It's a key component, the depleted lithium and so on. So that's
without highly depleted lithium, we simply won't be able to do these things.
Yeah, excellent. Well, thank you, Kirk. As always, excellent talk.